Students, my name is Suresh Kumar. In the previous video, I was telling you the tax provisions on Chapter 1 of Income Tax. I was telling you the provisions of Section 1 and some of the important definitions under Section 2. Also, I explained the provisions of Section 3, that is the definition of previous year. And this video is on Chapter 2, the basis of charge, that includes Section 4, the charging section of income tax, Section 5, the scope of total income, Section 6, how to determine the residential status of person, Section 7, income deemed to be received, Section 8, chargeability of dividend income, and Section 9, income deemed to accrue or arise in India, that is specifically applicable to non-residents. Now we are going to Chapter 2 of Income Tax Act. That is basis of charge. In this chapter, we will consider the following sections. Section 4, chargeability of income tax. Section 5, scope of total income. Section 6, how to determine the residential status of a person. Section 7, income deemed to be received. Section 8, taxability of dividend income. Of course, this is though it is given under Chapter 2, we will consider this only under the head income from other sources. And Section 9, income deemed to accrue or arise in India. Particularly, this is applicable to non-residents. Then Section 4 is the charging section. And what is the relevance of a charging section in a taxing statute, that is fiscal statute? Let me bring you to the earlier definition or the meaning of the tax. I was telling you the meaning as compulsory contribution. That is, the taxes are imposed on the subject, that is people. That is, it is compulsory and people are not voluntarily contributing tax. And when such a tax is imposed, how will you interpret a taxing statute? What is meant by interpretation? The way court consider the enactment as a whole for judicial purpose. Therefore, interpretation of a taxing statute or fiscal statute is very important. Now, how will you interpret a taxing statute? As I said, it is a compulsory contribution and tax is imposed on the subject and it is considered as a burden on the subject, people. That is, tax imposes a burden upon the subject. That is, it is compulsorily imposed. Hence, the taxing statute can be strictly constructed. The parliament will have to make its intention clear in the taxing statute. Every statute is an intention of parliament. The members are making the legislature and it is the intention of the parliament. The parliament will have to make its intention very clear in a taxing statute. You can understand this wording while explaining this Section 4. Section 4 is the taxability of income. That is, what is the relevance of this statement? Parliament will have to make its intention clear in the taxing statute. That is given, a person cannot be taxed without clear words for that purpose. That is, there must be a charging provision in every taxing statute. That is the importance of section 4. That is, a person cannot be taxed without clear words for that purpose in a taxing statute. However, if a person can be brought within the four corners of the taxing statute, the court cannot take a lenient view and relieve him from the burden. Suppose the person has taxable income, he is unable to pay tax, he cannot be taken out of such a burden. That is, first there must be clear-cut wordings in the enactment to tax a person, and once the person is within the four corners of this taxing statute, it is his obligation to pay tax, and no other burden can be taken him out of such a tax liability. This is how a taxing statute should be constructed. And suppose a particular provision can be interpreted in two ways. For example, there are two permitted computations for the same income, and one computation gives a higher income and the other computation a lower income. The one which is favoring the subject should be taken. That is what is given. If the words of the taxing statute are reasonably capable of two interpretations, one in favor of the subject and other one in favor of the revenue, the interpretation in favor of the subject is considered as good. These are all very important in understanding the tax provision. Therefore, the interpretation of this fiscal statute is very important to understand any taxing enactment. Now let's begin with section 4. Section 4 is the charging section, and it provides that the total income of the previous year of a person shall be charged to income tax. What is taxable is total income. Now, what is total income? Total income is defined under section 2 subsection 45. Section 2 subsection 45 defines total income as the total income computed under section 5. We will consider section 5 later. What is provided under section 5 is taxable under section 4. Section 5 is the scope of total income. What is meant by scope of total income? The way you are computing, or the limit within which you are computing the total income, which is taxable. Therefore, what is taxable is the total income. And this total income is defined under section 2 subsection 45 defines total income to mean total income computed under section 5. And later we will study what is gross total income. It is defined under section 80 capital B. 80 capital B defines gross total income as the total income computed according to the provisions of income tax before giving deduction under chapter 6A. In chapter 6A, this is chapter 2 of income tax. Later under chapter 6A, we will study what are all the deductions permitted under the income tax to compute the total income. Therefore, we have a few more terms. One is gross total income and other one is total income. Gross total income is the total income computed according to the provisions of income tax. What is the relevance of computed according to the provisions of income tax? Later under section 5, section 5, in the scope of total income, we will study the scope of total income is the computation of total income of resident or computation of total income of non-resident. In both the provisions, it is provided that the total income should be computed according to the provisions of income tax. That is, the total income should be computed according to the provisions of income tax. That is section 5, which is the core section in computing total income, which provides that the total income shall be computed according to the provisions of income tax. And hereinafter we will study how to compute the total income according to the provisions of income tax. And this total income means gross total income minus chapter 6A deduction. And that is what is taxable under section 4. Therefore, it is the total income of previous year. Tax, what is taxable is total income of previous year. This is the relevant and of a person be charged to income tax at the rate prescribed in the Finance Act applicable to the relevant assessment year. This is the relationship between previous year and assessment year. In the previous chapter we defined what is a previous year and what is an assessment year. Previous year is the financial year immediately preceding the assessment year. And it has another proviso: in the case of new business or new source of income, previous year means the date of commencement of business and ending with the 31st March of the relevant year. Therefore, the total income of the previous year is taxed in the relevant assessment year. Now, once again, the total income of the previous year of a person, and this person is defined under section 2 subsection 31, that is individual, HUF, company, firm, AOP or BOI whether incorporated or not, and artificial juridical person, etc. Therefore, person shall be understood according to the provisions of section 2 subsection 31. Therefore, in this case, the total income is defined under section 2 subsection 45, and this is subject to section 5, scope of total income. And the previous year is defined under section 2 subsection 34, and it is explained under section 3. Person is defined under section 2 subsection 31. Therefore, these are the relation between total income, previous year, person, and of course assessment year is defined under section 2 subsection 9. Now, once again, the total income of the previous year. The normal rule is that the total income of the previous year is taxed in the assessment year. But there are some exceptions. What is exception? Normal rule or normal statement: total income of the previous year assessed in the assessment year. What is assessed in the year other than assessment year? It is the case where the total income is assessed in the previous year itself. There are 5 cases. These are all the exception, very important for your examination. Normally the question will be like, what are the provisions of section 4? or what are the charge on income tax, or what is the basis of charge of income tax, what are all its exception. There are five exceptions. It is given under section 172, 174, 174A, 175 and 176. In the case of 172, it is the shipping business of a non-resident. Income of shipping business of a non-resident. That is, when a ship is chartered by a non-resident and ship at the port of India, the ship is allowed to leave the port only after tax has been paid or satisfactory arrangements for the payment of tax is made. Similarly, if a person is leaving India for employment or some other purpose, that person is allowed to leave India only after meeting his tax liability. And similarly, in the assessment of AOP or BOI or other artificial juridical person formed for a particular purpose, that is, if that particular purpose is completed in the previous year itself, the assessing officer need not wait till the commencement of the assessment year to collect the tax. It will be collected in the previous year itself. Similarly, section 175, person likely to transfer the property to evade tax. And in 176, that any income from discontinued business or profession will be taxed in the previous year itself. Therefore, the total income of previous year. Whenever you are considering this previous year, the total income of the previous year is assessed in the next assessment year, you should go to the exceptions. That is, these are the case where the total income is taxed in the previous year itself. Therefore, total income of the previous year of a person shall be charged to tax at the rate prescribed in the Finance Act. Normally, the rate of taxes are given in the Finance Act. Definitely, as we are proceeding, we will come across some provisions in the Income Tax Act that prescribe the rate of tax. That is, the rate of taxes are normally provided in the Finance Act, and there are situations when the Income Tax Act gives you the rate of tax act applicable. For example, in the case of long-term capital gain, it is provided under the Income Tax Act. And now the question, can the tax be collected in advance? Of course, that is what is provided in the section 4. In respect of income chargeable to tax, tax shall be deducted at source, that is, there can be TDS, or it can be paid in the form of advance tax. This area we will study later. The mode of collection of tax, it can be either self-assessment tax or through TDS, that is tax deducted at source, or TCS, tax collected at source, or advance tax. The mode of recovery of income tax will be studied later. Now section 5, what is taxable under section 4 is the total income, and section 5 is scope of total income. Scope of total income means the way you are computing the total income, and section 5 gives you computation of a resident and computation of non-resident. In section 5, subsection 1 gives you the computation of total income of resident, and it is provides that the total income of a person being resident is computed. That is, 5-1 is computation of total income of a resident. And there is a proviso, special case, how to compute the total income of a not ordinarily resident. That is, this includes two parts. One is the provision, and second one, there is a proviso, that is exceptional case. That is, how to compute the total income of not ordinarily resident. And section 5, subsection 2 is the computation of total income of a non-resident. That is, this section provides the computation of total income of resident, that is ordinarily resident, and there is a special provision to compute the total income of not ordinarily resident, and it is given as the proviso to section 5 subsection 1. And there is another subsection 2, that is computation of total income of non-resident. Before analyzing this section or how to compute the total income of a person, we must understand that total income is based on the residential status of a person, which is given in under section 6 of Income Tax Act. Therefore, we will consider the provisions of section 5. After studying the provisions of section 6, that is how to determine the residential status of a person. As section 5 is the computation of total income, and section 5-1 computation of total income of resident, 5-2 computation of total income of non-resident, we must understand that the computation is based on the residential status. And 5-1 and 5-2 gives the computation of total income of a person. There is a computation of the total income of a person. And the person has been defined under section 2, subsection 31, to include individual, Hindu undivided family, a company, a firm, an association of person or body of individual, etc. And for the purpose of section 5, the residential status should be computed with respect to each of the person. That is, we will be able to determine what is the residential status of individual, what is the residential status of, or how to determine the residential status of Hindu undivided family, how to determine the residential status of a company, and AOP, BOI, etc. for the purpose of section 5. And it is given under section 6. And section 6, subsection 1 gives the provisions how to compute or how to determine the residential status of individual. In order to determine the residential status of individual, we have two sets of conditions. First, basic conditions. If any one of the basic condition is satisfied, resident. If none of the basic conditions are satisfied, non-resident. What are the basic conditions, or what are the conditions given under sections 6, subsection 1? to determine the residential status of an individual, the two conditions are he is in India in that previous year. Now you should understand, section 4 is the chargeability of total income of assessment year. Therefore, the residential status should also be determined for the assessment year, and the condition is he is in India in that year. The residential status is based on the period of stay in India in the previous year, relevant to the assessment year. That is, for every assessment year, you should determine which is the relevant previous year, and the individual is resident in India in a previous year based on the fulfillment of two conditions. The first condition is he is in India in that previous year for a period or periods amounting in all to 182 days or more. That is, if the individual is in India for a period altogether in India for the relevant previous year, and the period shall be 182 days or more, then he is resident in India. An alternative provision, he is in India in that previous year for a period or periods amounting in all to 60 days or more during the relevant previous year, and 365 days or more during 4 years preceding the previous year. That is, in total, you may consider 5 consecutive previous year, that is divided into 2. First, the relevant previous year, and 4 years preceding the previous year. And for the relevant previous year, that is the previous year for which you are computing the total income, the individual shall be in India for a period or periods amounting in all to 60 days or more, and 365 days during 4 years preceding the previous year. If any one of the basic conditions is satisfied, the individual is resident in India. And if the individual does not satisfy both the basic condition, both these conditions given, then the individual is non-resident in India. Two special cases are given under section 6, subsection 1. These are special cases. There is a case where individual, a citizen of India, leaving India. The second case, a citizen of India or person of Indian origin coming into India for a visit. Two special cases. That is, if an individual who is a citizen of India leaving India, only first basic condition is to be considered. That is, he is a resident in India if he has been in India for a period or period amounting in all 182 days or more. The second basic condition, the 60 days or more during the previous year, and the 365 days or more during 4 years preceding the previous year is not relevant. Only the first basic condition is applicable. Similarly, a citizen of India is or person of Indian origin residing outside India is coming into India for a visit. Then also, the second basic condition is not applicable. Only first basic condition, that is, he is a resident only if he is in India for a period or period amounting in all 182 days or more during the previous year. Take the case one, individual who is a citizen of India leaving India in any year for the purpose of employment. If the person is leaving India for the purpose of employment, person who is resident in India or citizen of India and he is leaving India for the purpose of employment, or as the member of the crew of an Indian ship, the member of the crew of an Indian ship, then the second basic condition is not applicable. He is resident in India if he has been in India for a period or period amounting in all 182 days or more. Otherwise, he is non-resident. Similarly, a person residing outside India who is a citizen of India or person of Indian origin, then also he is resident only if he has been in India for a period or period amounting in all to 182 days or more during the relevant previous year. Section 5, subsection 1 is the computation of total income of resident, and there is a proviso to section 5, subsection 1. It is the computation of total income of not ordinarily resident. That is, the residential status can be divided into a resident and ordinarily resident, resident but not ordinarily resident, and non-resident. Section 5, subsection 1 gives you the computation of total income of ordinary resident and not ordinarily resident. And section 5, subsection 2 gives you the computation of total income of non-resident. Therefore, we will be able to determine the residential status of not ordinarily resident in addition to the basic condition. That is, whenever you are determining the residential status of a person, first you may ascertain whether resident or non-resident. And in the case of individual and HUF, if the residential status is ascertained as resident, then you will determine whether he is ordinary resident or not ordinary resident. To determine the status of not ordinarily resident, we must examine the other two conditions given under section 6, subsection 6 of Income Tax Act. The first one, if he is non-resident in 9 years out of 10 years preceding the previous year, and he has been in India for a period of 729 days or less during 7 years preceding the previous year. If any one of the additional condition or both the additional conditions are satisfied, the individual is resident but not ordinarily resident. Let's consider an example. It is to determine the residential status of Mr. X during the previous year 2019-20 relevant to the assessment year 2021. That is, you are determining the residential status of Mr. X for the relevant assessment year 2020-21. The period of stay in India is given, and how to determine the residential status. Let's prepare a working note on the on this question. That is, it is given the relevant previous year. You are determining the residential status of this previous year, and 10 years preceding the previous year also given, and it is the residential status of an individual. We studied that these are all based on two sets of conditions. First set is considered as the basic conditions. If any one of the basic condition is satisfied, resident. And if the status is resident, you should ascertain whether the individual is ordinarily resident or not ordinarily resident. For which we have another set of conditions, which is known as additional condition. What are the basic conditions? That the individual is in India for a period or period amounting in all 182 days or more during the relevant previous year. Or the second one, he is in India in that year for 60 days or more, or 365 days or more during 4 years preceding the previous year. Let us consider the basic condition, and we must ascertain whether the individual is in India for a period or period amount. That is, the individual is satisfying the any one of the basic conditions. Take the, and this is a working note, this previous year is given, period of stay in India is given in days, and you should determine the residential status of each of the year. Residential, first to determine the residential status of the relevant previous year. Relevant previous year is 2019-20. What is the first basic condition? He is in India for a period or periods amounting in all 182 days or more. The individual has been in India only for 99 days, and he is not satisfying the first basic condition. If the first basic condition is not satisfied, please look to the second basic condition. What is the second basic condition? He is in India for a period or periods amounting in all 60 days or more during the relevant previous year. There are more than 60 days and 365 days during 4 years preceding the previous year. Take 4 years preceding the previous year and ascertain how many days are in India in those 4 years. There are 378 days. The second basic condition is satisfied. Therefore, he is resident in India in that year, that is 2019-20. And for the purpose of section 5 and proviso to section 5, once the residential status is determined as resident, we must ascertain whether Mr. X is ordinarily resident or not ordinarily resident, for which we must go through the additional conditions. The additional conditions are, he is non-resident in 9 years out of 10 years preceding the relevant assessment year. sorry, relevant previous year. He is non-resident in 9 years, any one of the 9 years preceding the relevant previous year, or he has been in India for a period of 729 days or less during 7 years preceding the previous year. If any one or both the additional conditions are satisfied, not ordinarily resident, otherwise resident. Now we are going to determine the residential status of all the 10 years preceding the previous year. It is just to ascertain whether he is resident or non-resident in those years. Take year 1 preceding the previous year, apply the basic condition to determine resident or non-resident. He is in India for a period or period amounting in all 182 days, that is not satisfied. Then let's check whether the second basic condition is satisfied. 60 days or more, or 365 days or more during 4 years preceding the previous year. Then how many days are there? Number of days preceding the 4 years preceding 2018-19, this amounts to 63 plus 64 plus 180 plus 65, 372. That is, the second basic condition is satisfied, therefore he is a resident in this given case. Then we may consider 2017-18. The first basic condition is not satisfied because there is now 182 days. You may check whether the second basic condition is satisfied. This is ₹384, therefore resident for this period. And for the third previous year, 180 days only, therefore first basic condition is not satisfied, therefore it is 332, resident. And if you verify the other period of stay, you will find that Mr. X is resident in all the 10 years preceding the previous year. That is, the first additional condition is not satisfied. The first additional condition is that he is non-resident in 9 years out of 10 years preceding the previous year. But in this case, he was resident for all the years preceding the previous year. Now we have one more condition to be checked under the additional condition. That is, he is in India for a period less than 729 days during 7 years preceding the previous year. Take the 7 years, that is from 2018-19 to 2012-13. These are the 7 years preceding the relevant previous year of 2019-20. How many days he were in India? There were 630 days during 7 years preceding the previous year, which is less than 729 days. That is, he satisfies the second basic condition. That is, where the individual satisfies either one or both the additional condition, he is resident but not ordinarily resident. And in this case, Mr. X is resident but not ordinarily resident. Now the residential status of Hindu undivided family. It is based on control and management. Control and management means the place where the decisions of HUF is normally made. This simply means the place of the manager of HUF, which is known as the Karta of HUF. And if the control and management is wholly or partly situated in India, that resident is, if the control and management is wholly or partly situated in India, then the HUF is known as resident. And if the control and management is wholly outside India, HUF is not resident. Once the residential status of HUF is determined as resident, then we must look into whether the manager of HUF satisfies the additional conditions applicable to individual. If the manager of HUF satisfies any one or both the additional conditions applicable to HUF, that HUF is resident but not ordinarily resident. Hence, in the case of individual and HUF, the residential status can be ordinary resident, not ordinary resident, and non-resident. Section 6, subsection 3 deals with the residential status of a company. Companies are divided into two, one Indian company and other company. Indian companies are always resident in India. Indian companies are always resident in India. And with respect to other company, the residential status is based on the place of effective management. Place of effective management is the place where the key management and commercial decisions are made. If the place of effective management is in India, the company is resident, otherwise non-resident. And in the case of company, there are only two stages, either resident or non-resident. And it is applicable to Indian company and other company. Indian companies are always resident, and in the case of other company, place of effective management, if it is in India, resident, otherwise non-resident. Now section 6, subsection 4, the residential status of firm, AOP and others. In this case also, the status is determined based on control and management, that the place where the decisions are made. If the control and management is wholly or partly in India, that is resident, otherwise non-resident. That is, if it is wholly outside India, that person is non-resident. Section 5 provides scope of total income, means the way you are computing total income. What is the relevance of this section? And it is for the purpose of section 4. What is provided under section 4 is the taxability or income tax is charged on total income. And section 2, subsection 45 defines total income means total income computed according to the provisions of section 5. That is, the section 5 gives you the way of computing total income. That is the meaning of the term scope of total income. There are two subsections, section 5 subsection 1 and section 5 subsection 2, and there are two explanations. Now section 5 subsection 1 has three subsections and one proviso provided that this is a special case. It is computation of total income of person who is resident in India. Section 5 is the computation of total income of resident, and there is a proviso which gives you how to compute the total income of a person who is not ordinarily resident in India. That is, section 5 is computation of total income of resident. It also provides the computation of total income of not ordinarily resident. Then what are all the items included in the total income of a resident? That is, subject to the provisions of the Act, Act means Income Tax Act, the total income of any previous year of a person. The same thing is given in section 4 also, total income of the previous year of a person. That is, it is for the purpose of section 4, the total income of the previous year of a person who is a resident includes first income received. Income received in India subject to the provisions of the Act, the total income of persons who is a resident includes all income from whatever source. Later we will study 5 heads of income: salaries, income from house property, profits and gains of business or profession, capital gains, and income from other sources. These 5 heads normally describes the sources of income for the computation of total income. That we will discuss later. And section 5 also gives, in the case of a resident, the income from whatever source is included in the computation of total income. Income from whatever source is included in the computation of total income. And such income is received in India or deemed to be received in India. If an income, for example salary received in India, house property income received in India, business income received in India, capital gains received in India, and various items described under the head income from other sources which is received in India. That is how we may understand this provision. That is, in the case of a resident, income received from any source of income is included in the scope of total income. If the income is received in India, it is included in the computation of total income. Therefore, first item, received or deemed to be received. Then accrues or arises or deemed to accrue or arise in India in the previous year. and accrues or arise to him outside India during such year. This is another way of taxation. We are discussing the computation of total income of resident, and when computing the total income of resident, the income from any source which accrues or arises to him outside India, that is, even if the source of income is outside India, it will be taxed in the hands of a person who is resident in India. Later we will study it as residence-based taxation. In the case of residence-based taxation, the global income is taxed in the hands of a resident, and that is what is given in the three subclauses of this section 5. That is, income received in India, income accrues or arises or deemed to accrue or arise in India, income accrues or arises to the resident outside India is included in the computation of total income. And there is a special provision in the case of not ordinarily resident. In the case of a person who is not ordinarily resident in India, and according to section 6, subsection 6, that we already studied how to determine the residential status as not ordinarily resident, income which accrues or arises to him outside India shall not be included unless it is derived from a business controlled in India. In the case of not ordinarily resident, the income which accrues or arises outside India is taxed only when it is from a business which is controlled in India. If the business is controlled in India or profession is set up in India, then the income accrues or arises outside is taxable in the hands of not ordinarily resident. Section 5, subsection 2 gives you the way the total income of a non-resident is computed. And what is provided is, subject to the provisions of this act, the total income of previous year of a person who is non-resident includes income received or is deemed to be received in India in such year by or on behalf of such person. Second one, accrues or arises or deemed to accrue or arise to him in India during such year. That is, the income received outside India by a non-resident is not taxable. These are the provisions of section 5, two subsections. Subsection 1, computation of total income of resident. That includes how to compute the total income of not ordinarily resident. And 5, subsection 2 gives you the way of computing the total income of non-resident. Now we can conclude the provisions of section 5, subsection 1 and subsection 2 as per this table. In this table, these rows are given the sources of income, and in the columns there are residential status. That the taxability can be explained in either way, either source based taxation or residence based taxation. That is, if the source of income, this is income received or deemed to be received in India, and this is income accruing or arising or deemed to accrue or arise in India. In this case, the sources of income is in India. If the source of income is in India, This is known as source based taxation. If the source is in India, whether it is received in India or deemed to be received in India or accruing or arising or deemed to accrue or arise in India, it is taxable even in the hands of non-resident. That is, in the case of source-based taxation, if the source is in India, it is taxable even in the hands of non-resident. And the other one is residence-based taxation. If it is residence-based taxation, and in the case of ordinary resident, even the global income, that is income deemed to accrue or arise outside India, is taxable. This is the taxation based on residence, and this will give you the taxation based on source. That is, the taxability can be either based on source or based on residence. And in this particular case, not ordinarily resident, income received outside India is taxable in India if it is from a business which is controlled in India, and in the case of profession, it is set up in India. And an explanation is given to this section, that is, if the income is taxed on a receipt basis, it will not be again taxed on accrual basis and vice versa. That is, once the income is taxed on receipt basis, it is not taxed on accrual basis, or the income is taxed on accrual basis, it will not again be taxed on receipt basis. Now, section 7, income deemed to be, certain income is deemed to be received, that we will discuss in detail later. This includes employee's contribution in excess of 12% of salary, interest credited to provident fund account balance, interest credited to the recognized provident fund account balance in excess of 9.5% per annum, and a transferred taxable balance from unrecognized provident fund to recognized provident fund, and the amount which is specified under section 80CCD. These provision we will discuss under the head salaries. Now, section 8, dividend income. Dividend is defined under section 2, subsection 22, and this will be studied detailed under the head income from other sources. In this video, I was telling you the provisions of chapter 4. On section 4, section 5, section 6, section 7, section 8, and section 9. Section 4 is the chargeability of total income. Section 5 is the scope of total income, which is the computation of total income for the purpose of section 4. Section 6 is the determination of residential status of person, and it is for the purpose of section 5. And the residential status should be computed for a person means every person. That is, how to determine the residential status of individual into undivided family, a company, firm, etc. as described under section 2, subsection 31. And section 7, income deemed to be received, and section 8, dividend income, section 9, income deemed to accrue or arise in India in the hands of non-resident. And this video does not cover the provisions of section 9, and I will come up with the other video on section 9, income deemed to accrue or arise in the hands of non-resident.